So we are in session 28 today. We are getting into the HR project implementation, and in this session we will start with the design specification, starting with functional requirements, non-functional requirements, technical specifications, and the design, showing the use case diagrams, system design, package diagrams, domain object model, which is DOM, using POCO, just plain old C# objects, and business workflow layer, BWL design, and data access layer design, activity diagrams, what they are and how they look like and how can we use it, sequence diagrams, deployment diagrams, and many others. This session will give you a complete design overview of our real-time applications in the real world. Okay, so let's look into this session 28. Okay, so we got to walk through the project requirements as we decided to go with the HR project as a last step of the training process, and we're going to cover the requirements that we have laid out as part of the training session. So the requirement again, just walk through the high level requirements with respect to the functional areas of the project. Here in this case, the XYZ Corporation is looking for an online web application to manage their global human resource. It's ideally pretty simple human resource application. And some of the functional requirements are laid out in the bottom. And each of the requirements, as we see, has an ID associated to each of them on the left-hand first column, R1 to R5. So R1 is a requirement which talks about managing employee information, which is pretty much asking to have a screen to have to edit, delete, and create employee information, and as well as R2 is also talking about a similar screen for department information, and R3 is an employee search information screen wherein users can search for employees based on the user employee ID, name, and department. And R4 is a little addition to that. This is a little special screen wherein the admin users want to access and modify the user privileges on the application side. So wherein the admin, this is an admin screen wherein the admin user can go and map the user roles and resources so that he can grant or revoke privileges for different users to different groups of the application. So in general, you might have you definitely have a fair idea about what is an admin and general users. You know, so most of the cases, the admins will have the high level authority to go through the screens and manage and control the other users' privileges, and so that the admins will have a special access to the application. So some of the screens in our application too will have some of the screens where only admins can access, and some of the screens are the only general users can gain access. In general, admins will also have access to the screens that general users have access. So we'll see that implementation as well. This is, in other words, called as an authorization implementation. Okay, so role-based authorization is what we're talking about in general. And the R5 talks about the employee information as a service, so that we're going to have expose the same information that we have captured as part of R1 and R2 requirements and expose expose that data as a service. So this will be another requirement wherein we're going to fulfill using services or different technologies. So we're going to talk about what are the technologies that we're going to use. And report requirements, where there's R6 and R7, there's one of the R6 requirement is that the active employee report is requested, or list all the active employees of for the given date. So this report talks about taking a given date, and for that given date, whatever the employees are active, we're going to retrieve active in general. What means is you might, as a firm, you might have hundreds of employees. Out of them, some got terminated or suspended, and some are might be on a long leave. So whoever is active, leaves is not generally considered here. So whoever terminated or suspended or left the firm, they are inactive. All others will be active. So they are still enrolled in the company and they are working. Leave is not the factor there. Okay. And R7, so that's kind of a detailed requirement. You know, this is like a high level requirement. So once you get into the detail level requirements, that's when, you know, you really define what do you mean by active users. So we are a little far from that stage. At this stage, we just have a high level requirements, and this is what you get normally even in real-time project. So this is pretty much everything what I'm doing today or going forward. All the sessions is what exactly a real-time scenario. So this is nothing more or nothing less. In other words, some projects might do little less than what I'm going to show you, or some projects might do little more than what I'm trying to show you. So in general, these are the steps that a usual software development lifecycle will go through. So if you map this phase of our software development lifecycle, we are at the inception phase, wherein we haven't yet gone into the requirements gathering. This is just an inception stage where the end client brought up a business idea or concept to build as an application. So this is just a business concept or an idea at an inception phase. Okay, so at this point we don't have any detail level requirements. Okay, so based on this, the rest of the whoever team they need, they will be started building the respective team and then do the requirements gathering sessions and other things. So we'll actually walk through each phase in our approach. So this is a high level functional requirements page one, and then the page two we have a little bit of a data requirements as well. Wherein they want to capture the employee information, wherein you have employee ID, first name, last name, sex, date of birth, address, email, phone. So pretty simple. Okay, it's a pretty simple employees page. And of course, there are some of the detail level information also provided in this slide, wherein the ID is a required field, and it's going to be unique employee identifier. So it's going to be unique. That means no two values will be same. So that's what it indicates. And also first name, last name, similarly names cannot take any special characters and other things. So those are some of the data field validations descriptions given here. And for sex, again, F and M is the only two letters they can accept. And for date of birth, it cannot be a future date. And for address, it should be a valid address, and email and phone number. Ideally, in real-time scenarios, you might want to validate the address and email as well. As a real-time scenarios, you might have seen when you key in an email ID in anywhere, they will send you an email back saying confirm your email, so that you just verify that whether the given email ID is valid or not. So that's how the email ID is getting verified. In our case, we just want to see whether the email ID falls into the given expression, and then validate whether this is a valid email ID. In general, we're going to look for an at the rate symbol and the dot keywords in general. And also we'll see a two character following the dot, so on, like that. And phone number, of course, phone number is, again, all these are optional in this case. So whenever, if it's not blank, then we have to validate whether whatever user have entered is a valid phone number and address or email ID. And department also have the same, similarly, five fields. So these are the two screens that we're talking about wherein we're going to capture this information. So it's pretty simple and straightforward screens. And there are a couple of non-functional requirements as well as part of this. These are the requirements which will actually not a showstopper to the business. That means even if you don't provide this functionality, there's nothing going to happen actually to the day-to-day business activities of the application. But these requirements are essential for day-to-day maintaining the application in general, like the diagnostic logs, exception handling, logging, and the number of user loads. In this case, we just showed the security as an as a non-functional requirement. Ideally, security will be part of the the functional requirements for a kind of application. If it's a very mission critical or a very high sensitive applications like which deals with the financial activities, they are for them security has becomes a very critical functional requirement rather than a non-functional requirement. So just for an example sake, I'm just taking security as a non-functional requirement here. Okay, going forward, so what are the tools? So once we have the business requirements at a very high level, and then the next initial internal processes will involve people, associated people to identify what are the technologies we're going to use. So ideally at the solution architects or the infrastructure architects will be involved soon after the proposal is as part of the inception phase. When someone brings in a proposal, so that's actually discussed with the respective solution architects or the infrastructure architects or sometimes usability architects. So they will lay down, so okay, this kind of requirements can be fulfilled by these technologies, and that's when they come with a set of technologies that we're going to use to fulfill this application. And of course, there are various criteria people normally follow to evaluate which technology or which tool will surface their surface these requirements, and that's when you see so many different technologies available in the market, and choosing a right tool for the right application is one of the very high skilled task, and that's when people who have a very enormous experience in that area, they usually get involved in making the decisions to choose which one best fits here. So in our application, so since we our core domain or the technology we are dealing with is with the complete Microsoft platform, so we choose to go with the Visual Studio 2010, ASP.NET and a web application to fulfill the web-based application requirements, and of course Visual Studio 2010 is an IDE. We can leverage that as a base platform for doing everything, including your project management, your build cycle, including your version controlling, and also building the application, debugging, deploying, everything. So everything is we can do in Visual Studio 2010. And of course, ASP.NET is one of the type of a project that you can create, which is a web-based project. And we're going to use ASP.NET for this project. And of course, for handling the service requirements, we're going to use the WCF, which stands for Windows Communication Foundation, using Visual Studio 2010. And of course, we're going to have the latest software again, the operating system that we're going to use here for development as well as for hosting this website. We're going to use the Windows 7 operating system. And AdWords.NET will be using for data access, activates data objects for .NET in general. So if you know the older ones, activates data objects for VB6 and earlier languages. So for .NET, we have AdWords.NET again. It's .NET flavor of the same AdWords, which is activates data objects, which can talk to any sort of databases in general. And we want to use also the enterprise library. I just mentioned here 4.1, and we can actually make use of 5.0, which is again the latest version in enterprise library. This is again for handling the exceptions and logging, validations, and data access. So we'll see how we can make use of enterprise library as an application blocks and ease our development cycle again. So we will talk more about this enterprise library going forward. Okay, and also SQL Server 2008. We're going to use SQL Server 2008 R2, and SSRS as part of the SQL Server 2008, and also SSRS we're going to use for reporting. We have R6 and R7 two report requirements. We're going to fulfill them using SSRS, and IIS 7. IS7, we're going to use for web hosting. So that's a web server that we're going to, in this slide I just put it as 7, but Windows 7 comes with some IIS 7.5, and we'll see how we can deploy the web application and host a web application on the IIS 7.5. And finally, we have Microsoft Visio 2007. Okay, so Visio is an EML modeling tool, wherein it's not exactly UML modeling tool, it's just a modeling tool wherein you can make use of any sort of data modelings, and including UML diagrams, and which is actually the starting point for your developing a project. So we are at the inception phase, and we identified the tool set that we're going to use. That's where we are. Okay. And yes, this is one of the slide which will already shared with you guys, and most of you already have this softwares downloaded and installed, which is available also with the links. If you don't have the licensed version, definitely you can actually get the express editions, which are free. Of course, because they are free, they have some kind of limitations in the way the features are available, but I believe that whatever we're going to do, all those are available as part of the Express Editions, okay? So you can get the Express Editions for both the Visual Studio 2010 and as well as the SQL Server 2008. So both are available for free. You can download and install and get your machines ready. And Enterprise Library is again free. There's no charge for that. And that MSI, you can download and install. And of course, IIS, it comes as part of your host operating system. If you're using XP or Windows 7, doesn't matter. So operating systems is really not a concern here. You have both, you have 32-bit and 64-bit kind of applications you can create in Visual Studio 2010. If you have the older version of Visual Studio, that's also fine. But if you are using Visual Studio 2008, then there will be a completely different way things can be done. It will be little deviated from the way I'm going to walk through. So if it's always advisable to have Visual Studio 2010. Okay. So this is the part of the first phase we are in. We are actually entered into the design phase. We walk through the inception phase, where we have a high level requirements, and we walk through the detailed design, where we have the employee detail, field level information. So that's what happens in the detailed design phase or requirements phase. Sorry, and soon after the requirements phase comes in the design phase. So this is part of the SDLC phase, which we discussed in one of the previous sessions. And in the design phase, one of the key diagrams as part of the UML is the use case diagrams. And this slide talks about the use case diagrams mapping to the requirements that were laid out. So if you see the R1, R2, R3, R4, so on. So if you look at these, if you take a little step down to the UML diagrams, the core elements in the UML diagrams will be an actor just like a human, if you see on the left hand side and the right hand side, and an oval shape object, which this is a call as the use case. And the arrows pointing to the respective use cases indicates that the respective user is using this use case. Again, and within the boundaries, if you see the entire rectangle, wherein the user is outside that rectangle and the oval is inside the rectangle, that indicates the system boundaries. So wherein this whole boundary is the application boundary, so that means this oval is available as part of the application boundary. So this is why the application boundary in this case is XYZ Corporation HR Web Application. And it clearly says functional requirements use case diagram. So that means these ovals are the use cases that are available as part of this web application, and general user or admin user can access these use cases as part of the as part of the application. So what this information translates down the line to the real-time application. So this use case diagram serves two things. Number one is the understanding between the what user wants and what vendor understood. So it's a pictorial representation of the communication between the vendor and the client. So once you have this pictorial representation, client will really realize, okay, this is what I'm asking for. Yes, this is what I'm asking for. So in this case, if you map this to the textual-based requirements, which we saw in the first slide, the manage employee information is one of the requirements. We don't know the details. This one doesn't tell you any details. This one tells you at a high level, okay, these are the individual elements or at a high level that you are looking for. This is to just to identify the high level requirements that the client is looking for so that you don't miss out any junk of requirements that user is looking for. So this will give you a clarity or clarity of the vision and scope of your application that is going to be built at the high level. So use case is very, very useful in making the communication clear and crystal between the vendor and the client. That's number one. And number two is once these are identified, it's easy for you to drill down into the detail of each and every aspect. So the, once, as with respect to the vendor-specific scope-wise, each of these ovals will be actually translated to as an action items on your application. In general, if you look at this, manage employee information. So if you look at the home page, each of these ovals will become a home page link, in other words. So again, so that means in this case, if I design a home page, I'm going to have number one, manage employee information as one of the hyperlink, wherein if someone hits on that link, it will take you to the screen wherein they can manage the employee information. That means the CRUD operations, right? Edit, delete, update. And similarly, manage department information. That's another hyperlink. So each of the ovals will actually translate to a component inside your program. So at the vendor level, they know how many components you are looking for to build. Okay, so that will give you a path for the for designing the application as a whole and also prepare the estimations for the project. In general, when the high level at the inception phase, when someone brings in some proposal that I'm going to build this application, you really don't know how much that's going to cost to build, right? At the high level, so you were looking for how many screens, how many reports, how many services? Do you have an account of that? No, at that stage, you're simply looking for a HR project. So once you lay down the use case diagram, you will have a clear picture of what you're trying to build, how many components you're looking for, to that number of components you can actually translate based on the complexity of each and every component, and based on the industrial average. Okay, if it is an ASPX page, if it is a medium complex, then it might take a 60 hours for a development. So that's how you know you come with the industrial average figures. Based on, again, the industrial average figures are based on the best guess and based on your experience, so that's why these things are evaluated by the technical folks at the high level. Usually the architects or the very senior developers or the program managers, so whoever have experience in large-scale applications, they can come up with their very good number estimates. And that's when the total estimates for the project is built and quoted. So once you quote the end user, so they will of course evaluate based on the requirements. So that's when the show go on. So finally you've bid the project and then you will move on. So that's how the things are done. So so use case is a very, very useful diagram. And again, you might not see every project have a use case diagram. Okay, so that's, again, no one says you must have a use case diagram, but it's always good to have, for the reasons we discussed just now. Okay, and next comes the next use case diagram, which talks about the non-functional requirements, wherein the security is one of the page. And of course, in the previous diagram, did I mention about the R4 use case, which is manage user versus role mapping? So this is, again, if you take a look, it also talks about the authorization requirements, wherein the general users cannot access the R4 requirement, whereas the admin users can access it. So in general, admin users have access to all these screens, and the general users don't have access to all these screens. So this is a very precise use case diagram that can explain a lot about what in terms of functionality, scope of the application, and also in terms of the authorization requirements and the roles. If you see, the indicate two different users sitting on left side and right side indicates that you are looking for two different roles, two different categories of people accessing this application. So it's a lot of information that's provided by this one diagram. So use case is a very, very useful diagram. And we're going to walk through a couple of more UML diagrams today. And of course, we'll try to start into the creating application. As I mentioned, so this is going to be like a walkthrough to each and every step in a real-time world. So today, you will see most of the diagrams as part of the design phase is concerned. What are the diagrams you're going to be building or you might be seeing? So in general, if you get into any project, two things might happen. It all depends upon which phase you're entering into the project. Suppose you're at the inception phase and someone asks you to prepare a UML diagrams like the use case diagram, so you might end up creating use case diagrams, okay? So it all depends upon your opportunity. So if you really ask someone ask you to create UML diagrams, then it's really a very good opportunity. So don't break your head and don't scream saying why people are asking me to do diagrams and do a lot of documentation. So that's very, very good experience, I would say. So yeah, you might get into a situation where people might ask you to do a UML diagrams. Also, if you're getting into a development phased project, then you might have to see these diagrams. So as part of the design phase, somebody might already done the use case diagrams or the class diagrams or activity diagrams or sequence diagrams, and they will actually give you those diagrams to you to build the project. So that's how they communicate the information to the down to the developers, so that developers can just walk through them and just start writing the code. So that's that level of information you will have it. So you might have to understand them if you are not creating them. Okay, so it's both the ways. It's very, very important for you to actually walk through these diagrams and understand what are the elements involved in these diagrams. Okay, so that's the reason I'm actually spending a lot of time on showing you these diagrams and walking you through them. Okay. And the second one, we have the security login page, wherein, of course, both users must log into the application. And the which is a non-functional requirement, 2, 3, 4 are completely non-functional. So it's user load is something we don't really do anything as part of training. In general, based on the user load, the infrastructure that you're going to require to handle the user load will be completely different, and there are a lot of things that you need to consider when the user load is going to be drastically a great number. Typical examples, if you say this is a simple HR project where I'm not expecting, if it is a large scale, large firm, I'm not expecting 200 or 300 users hitting this application, or even the total user load could be 200, but concurrent user load could be 20 or 30 at a time. So it could be that level. And if you talk about a public website, for example, if you take a Facebook as an example, or a Gmail or Yahoo Mail, which are heavily hit by millions of users daily, hourly, every second, millions of users are hitting the page or using the functionality, then the complete architecture of the application will be completely different altogether. Might be, you have to definitely consider each and every line of code in your website, and also the infrastructure-wise, you might have to have a very large load balancers to have a heavy, big, clustered environment wherein the user load is distributed across multiple servers. So that's kind of a different scenario. So user load is a very, very complex non-functional requirement. Sometimes it's very critical again. In our case, it's not that critical because it's a simple HR project, and I'm expecting to have at least 20 concurrent users which can be easily satisfied by one web server. So I'm not looking for any load balancers here. Okay, and exception handling and logging is of course a very essential part of it. We're going to achieve that using the enterprise library application blocks and diagnostic logs. We'll see. So we are still at the use case diagrams, which is again a very high level design phase. And the last one is the employee information as a service. So this is about a service. So with R5, we're going to have this as a service completely. So this is again, if you look at the application scope. Okay, cool. Next diagram. So this is the next high level picture that we usually built as part of the solution. So based on the requirements that are laid out, so usually this kind of diagrams are done by the solution architects of your project. So they're going to give you a high-level picture how the application is going to look like and whether it's going to be a two-tier architecture or three-tier or n-tier and so on. So based on the, I'm not actually going to explain what are these different architectural styles and models available. If you are aware, that's very, very good. If you're not at all aware, then probably I can take that sessions in detail as part of the high-level trading, but for this I'm going to just limit to the final conclusion made to which architectural model we're going to build. And in this case, it's pretty much a three-tier architecture model. Otherwise, if I don't have a web service in this case, it is actually a two-tier architecture model. Yeah, as part of the three-tier architectural model here, I have a web service standing as a tier 3, and the first tier is a web application here, which is going to be our HR web application that we're going to build, and the tier 2 is our database server, wherein we have the database hosted here. So usually what happens is general confusion with the tiers. Usually if you look at the documentation online, when you talk about multiple tier or three tier architectural model, you have a presentation layer at the top, you have the business tier in the middle, and at the bottom you have a data tier. So that's how usually you come with a three tier architectural model. But what you will normally miss with that diagram or theory is that UI layer or tier is two different things. Layer and tier are two different things. You can have a UI layer and a business layer and data access layer, but you cannot call that as a three-tier architectural model because layers are usually logical separation of the code, but they are not physical separation of the code. So in this case, when you talk about tier, T-I-E-R, keyword, you always think about physical separation. So in this case, if you see, database is completely physically separated from the entire application. So definitely this is going to be on a different box, ideally, or if it is not on the other box, it can be on the same box, but still it's going to run physically in a separate process area. So SQL Server runs in a separate process area. It doesn't actually commingle with the application process areas. So whereas the web application runs in its own process area, even if it's on the same machine, usually in this case, it's a separate machine, as I showed. And the so that's why this is physically they are separated from each other. So that's when the multi-tier things comes into play. And of course, in this case, we have a web service again. So web service again runs in its own process area. So that's why it's a tier 3. Similarly, when you talk about entire application architecture model, so what it indicates is that you might have different components involved. It could be a COM component, or it could be a service component, or sometimes UI itself can be a part of a different application. You're talking to another web application and trying to achieve it. So it kind of, you can have a entire architecture involves too many things to talk to. So beyond a three-tier, it's entire. There's nothing like four-tier, five-tier. You can always say four-tier or five-tier because N is replaced with number. Entire talks about more than, you know, one-tier. So in our case, we're going to have a three-tier architectural model, but although all these three tiers are going to be hosted on the same machine for us, okay? Just for your information, I'm just depicting these various decisions that have been made to achieve this project. And this comes as part of the system design. So this system design is again as part of the design phase itself, wherein you design the system, how it's going to lay it out and how the interaction is going to be between the various hardware peripherals. In this case, of course, the end user is going to access the web application via the internet, that's your HTTP or HTTPS protocol, and it's, they can access only the web application part of it, and this is going to be usually been exposed with the outside your application boundary. In this case, if you see the so this is our application boundary where an XYZ corporation network, so this is our LAN considering. So within the network, you can have it, of course, this application might be hosted on the DMZ area wherein it's accessible by the users on the internet, and the rest of the infrastructure can be hidden outside, outside the DMZ so that it's protected, so that people don't access your infrastructure from outside directly and do necessary things. Again, that's again too much of detailed information. I don't want to go in and distract or deviate from our topic. So at the high level, we have the high level solution architecture diagram, which considered to have a three-tier architectural model. First tier is going to be an application, and the second tier is a database, and the third one is a web service. Okay, so that's when the decision is made. And next comes the another layered view of the architecture. So this is a layered architectural view, wherein the whole application, the same high level view is decomposed into a little bit deeper to see what are the different layers that we're going to build to achieve or build this application. So when the layered approach, in other terms, we're going to see a package diagram in detail in when we see the UML terms of the same layered view. There are several considerations need to be made to determine how many layers we're going to have and how they're going to talk to each other. So proper layering has principles associated to them. There are packaging principles completely combined in designing the layers, which part you're going to put into which layer is very, that again leads to the reusability aspects of the of your components that you're building. So in general, we have the user interface layer, which is our UI, which could be ASPX and it could be its code behind in general, and the business workflow layer, wherein this is the immediate tier, that's or a layer, I won't call it as a tier because it's a logical layer, not a tier. So the business workflow layer is going to be involved in doing certain tasks. And what are those tasks? We'll see in detail. At this point, we don't know what each of these layers are doing. There are a certain number of diagrams that will follow, which will tell you what they're going to do. At a high level, so business workflow will be the immediate layer that will be accessed by the UI. That means the page is going to call this component and get its works done. And the workflow layer will actually call the data access layer. In other words, to keep it simple to what you already know, this is the UI layer, business layer, and data access layer. So those are three things. Okay, so those are three things which are, I think most of you are aware of. And in addition to this data access layer, we have two vertical bars we see here. One is a helper, another one is a domain object model. So what are these? So why these are vertical? These layers are horizontal layers, and these are vertical layers again. These vertical layers are accessible throughout these three layers. That's why they are vertical. okay? And of course, because these are horizontal, that means they don't span across each other, but they make use of each other. So again, UI can access workflow layer directly. There is no direct link between the UI to data access. So it's always through data business workflow. So that's what this horizontal layer communication happens, and the vertical layer communication happens. So when domain object model usually reflects to your the business entities in general. In our case, it's employee, department. These are the business classes that we're talking about, which really transform the business. So that's what can be transformed into domain object models. A domain in general is the problem area. In our case, the problem area is HR. HR is our domain. And the object model. So again, what is an object? We did talk about it several times. Okay, so objects within our domain, within the HR domain, what are the objects involved? If you look at, so we already know there is an employee object, there is a department object. Okay, those are the only two things we have seen in terms of with respect to the domain, right? To keep it simple, so in general, if you see a real-time project, you might see tens of objects or tens of classes, or definitely not hundreds, I won't say, but at least a couple of tens, like probably 20, 30 objects you might see. It can happen. In our example, it's pretty simple. To keep it straight, we have only two objects, okay? Business with respect to the domain object, okay? And the model. So domain object model. So model is a word that comes in when we talk about several objects identified in a domain and their relationship with each other. So that we'll see when we talk about the class diagrams. That's when we'll elaborately discuss what is a domain object model and what all you will see as part of the class diagram. And then comes the helper class, a helper module or the layer, which is a vertical layer. This is a helper project that you can have a different methods or constants or fields, anything that can be used throughout all the layers. So these are, in other words, these are called as the cross-cutting concerns. In other words, we are seeing another dimension of the cross-cutting concerns, which are in addition to what business wants in general. So the non-functional requirements, what we saw in the previous session, will normally translate to the cross-cutting concerns. That's the reason I just broken down the functional requirements and the non-functional requirements. Okay, so because the cross-cutting concerns are usually not the functional requirements that you're trying to address. They are going to address the non-functional requirements in general. Okay, so the helpers are the ones which can be used by anyone, any of these layers. For example, if you take a validation method or a constant, for example, if you want to have the name of the project as a constant and want to use it throughout the project, then you can have the constant declared somewhere in the helper class and make use of it throughout the layers wherever the application name you want to make use of it, you can actually make use of it. So that constant can be used across the layers, so that's why it's vertical. Okay, so next comes the cross-cutting concerns, which are pretty much our data access, which we are using, which we're going to achieve using the enterprise library. Okay, so in this case, all these cross-cutting concerns, which are non-functional requirements, we're going to make use of the enterprise library to achieve them. We're going to use pretty much three application blocks in our project. One is the data access application block, the exception handling application block, the logging application block. And of course, the enterprise library comes with a bunch of other application blocks, like the security application blocks, you have a caching application block, so on. So there are a bunch of others. And we're going to make use of the .NET Framework 4.0 at the bottom. So if you look at the layered architecture view, it talks about several other components that we're going to make use of it and how they are going to talk to each other. So in this part, so our application code is about this. right? So our application is code completely above this. So all these layers are our application blocks, in other words, and they are all going to be sitting on top of the framework blocks. The first block is again Enterprise Library 5.0, which is again sitting on top of the .NET framework. So the bottom part is the .NET framework, and everything else sits on top of other. That means this diagram also shows you the dependencies between all these various projects or assemblies. So bottom part of it is that we need to have a .NET framework 4.0. Okay, and of course you have the database SQL Server database, which is actually directly accessed using the data access application block. Of course, we did talk about AWR.NET. AWR.NET, we are going to make use of AWR.NET in data access layer. Okay, and of course AWR.NET can be made use as part of the data access application block itself. So application block has a couple of predefined functionalities to directly access the database and get things much simpler to use. Probably that's one of the good question you might think of asking: what are these application blocks? Do I really need to use them? Okay, definitely not. So you can write the program without any of these application blocks, definitely, yes. But why we are using it? That's a good question if you really ask me. Application blocks are, as the keywords say, they comes with a built-in standard set of functionalities that an enterprise level applications need in general. And you don't have to rewrite them again and again and again and again. Okay, so if you in an industry, if you look at any application, they definitely need any of these. Number one, data access. Two, exception handling. Logging, of course. So in general, if you look at a real-time application, every application needs some kind of logging mechanism. And of course, every application needs some kind of exception handling mechanism. So application blocks comes with as a packaged library, which you can actually leverage it directly without writing any code of your own. If at all, for example, for logging, we did talk about how to handle the file operations, file IO operations, right? So writing some content to a file and of course closing it. So there's a lot of code that you have to write to handle file operations in general. And in this case, the logging application blocks comes readily available with the set of libraries which you can actually just fine-tune, configure them, and just ready to use. So you don't have to write a code. So how good is that? So that's why we're going to use the application blocks to reduce our coding time, our development time, and get the high-level functionalities. Okay, so as application block, they are like, as I said, it's an enterprise library. That's why it's called an enterprise library, and it comes with all these things. So no matter which level of functionality you need, you can actually get it just by configuration. For example, I'll give you a very good example so that you can understand what I'm talking about. And of course, eventually we're going to see that. In general, if you're handling exceptions, for example, so you have a type of exceptions like at the UI level exception you're going to come, or you might have an exception at the business workflow layer or a data access layer. And each of these exceptions you want to handle in a different way. Example, you want to handle a UI type of exceptions to be logged into a different file or to be reported as a different way to a different mechanism. For example, if whenever UI exception happens, you want an administrator know that something happened in the UI, or if something happens on the database side, you want the DBN to know, so the database have failed for this reason. So things like that. So you want to bifurcate the various handling mechanism, so that you can achieve by introducing the exception handling policies. So you can have the policies defined and configured so that your exception handling application block can handle that the way you want it. So that level of handling mechanism is available as part of the application block. If at all you have to write the same code, then it's going to take several months or probably years to materialize and make it matured enough to consume it. So now Enterprise Libraries 5.0 is a very, very mature product. It just evolved over a period of time, probably at least 8 or 7 years old by now, to my guess. So it's evolved and it's completely ready to use. And of course, logging wise, it can also log as part of a text file or XML file, or you can log to a database also. So it's all just configuration based. So it's very rich to use. Okay, so now next comes the infrastructure architecture. This is the diagram that brings up the attention of the infrastructure requirements. Okay, so now you are into the project, you know what to do. But where are you going to host? Where are you going to build it? You definitely need a development environment. You need to have some staging environment to test it. And also you need some user acceptance testing. You need some environment wherein the application can be hosted and tested. And finally, the production environment. So for all these, you need servers, right? You need a hardcore servers to handle your application requirements. So that comes the infrastructure. So this server with this operating system, this server with this database, and so on. So all so the architecture-wise, the infrastructure architecture diagram will actually pretty much looks like this. So I'm showing you the pretty much the production diagrams. So I just created them for the sake of our project so that it benefits all of you. So this infrastructure diagram in this case, if you see on the left-hand side, it's a development environment, and I have a production environment on the right-hand side. Usually, production environment based on the scale of the project, you might see several clustered environments. In this case, we have SQL Server database servers as a clustered environment. In this case, active, passive cluster. Okay, I don't want to get into too many details again to elaborate too much of this diagram. To the scope of our discussion at this point, we're going to show you what is that an infrastructure diagram looks like and what does it contain. So it pretty much contains the boxes as a servers and their IP address of the servers, and also which protocol you're going to use to access them by the user or internally, and so on. So if you look at this diagram, it is being exposed as part of the TCP port 80 or 443. 80 is a default port for HTTP protocol, and 443 is a default port number for HTTPS protocol. So those are the standard protocols, either it could be HTTP or HTTPS. And yeah, if at all it's too confusing or you don't want to know that, that's fine. And so we have the web application server, what all it contains. It contains since this is a virtual environment, so that's why it's called a VM guest, and it has a RAM, so much of RAM, it has so much of disk space on CND drive, and it has the 64-bit operating system, crystal reports, and so on. So what are the softwares that this application need to have? All these are listed as part of the infrastructure diagram. So once this diagram is given to an infrastructure architect or the application engineer, they can actually straight away follow this and procure the required servers and install the required software and make it available so that your development environment is ready and the production environment is ready and the testing environment is ready, so that you can test, people can hook on and start developing, deploy, test it, right? Probably in a real-time situation, when you get into a project, you might not see any of these. Usually, if you're getting into a project as a developer, so that's already taken care of by someone by the time you get in. Or you might also might have to tell someone that you need these things and these need to be included, and even probably have to look at the infrastructure diagram and see what this infrastructure look like and what is missing. Okay, so on. So this is again a very useful diagram, or you may or may not see this in ideally. If at all you come to see this, you can understand it by looking at the diagram, right? And that's part of the system design. And and another important thing is the JAD sessions. Usually it comes as a joint application design phase, wherein the client and vendor sit together and discuss at a detail level requirements. Also, you might walk through the infrastructure or solution architecture diagrams based on the vendor's clients need, and you might talk to them. So these are the servers you need, and this is the hosting cost that might incur over a period of time or for down the line based on the capacity plan of your application. This is what you might look at. So if, for example, the database today, it's going to be only 10 GB database as part of the initial phase release. Down the line, this 10 GB might get consumed in a matter of an year. Probably the next year you might need a yearly server upgrades for storage upgrades of 10 GB at least on average in a year, or so on. So that's all part of the capacity plan. Based on the capacity plan, you will come with some kind of numbers to the client to tell them this is what the maintenance cost looks like. So JAR sessions are usually happens between the client and the vendor. This is again a series series of discussions to get the max inputs from the end user to make sure they have what they're looking for, and capture the field level requirements. That's when it happens in detail level design, followed by transforming the client's functional requirements or non-functional requirements into a technical design, which we have seen so far. And the next very detail level comes in. So now we soon after that high level architectural view, and also the infrastructure diagram you have the systems in place. Now comes in the very detailed level design, next part of it, such as like the field level validation or field level information or method level design will be taken place. So to actually there are several ways to do it. There are several diagrams available. One of the best model to my experience so far, and also to most of the industry folks, they do agree that this is one of the best model to follow to address different audiences within the project. If you look at the project in general, so you will see different types of audience, right? The client who is completely a master in his business. Okay, so they are sometimes referred to as subject matter experts, SMEs. So they know the business. And if you look at the vendor or the technical folks, right? So if you look at the your project manager, they know how to manage the project, okay? As a follow the SDLC phases, what need to be done at a given phase, who they need to hire at a given time, and how much time they need to put in. So all these activities the project manager know very well, but he don't know anything about the business, okay? And again, look at the other guys, like us in the field, who are completely technical. We just rely on what the other two say, right? We just wanted to know what you want to build. Okay, I know how to build, but you know what to build. Tell me what to build and within what time PM is going to tell. So based on that information, we're going to build. So you have three different high-level classification of people here. So one of the other, everyone relies on the information that each one provides. Okay, so because no one knows everything. So when you come with a design, an application, your design should be helpful in communicating things to any one of these user group. So that's when the 4+1 architectural review model comes into play with a very, very deal informative. So in this case, what is 4+1 architectural model talks about is four different views mapping to one center view, which is this. At the center, we have the scenarios. We did talk about the scenarios, right? And the scenarios are the stories, a storyboard, if you look at wherein the high-level requirements. In our case, when our employee got hired into this firm, they need to get enrolled into the system. So that's the story. So that means you will make use of the create employee screen to create an employee or enroll an employee into the firm. So that's the story. That's the scenario. So likewise, if you have a new department included as part of your firm expansion, or the given department name has changed, or given department head of the department has changed, so on. So that need to be updated in the system. So that's a storyline. That means it's a requirements that can be mapped as a story, and the story can actually map to n number of requirements given in the place. So those all becomes at the center heart of this model. And all these other models will be having a different viewpoints addressing the same center point. So that's what the 4 plus 1 architectural model talks about. So what does each do? So at the high level, if you take the logical view, a logical view will actually give you the information that an end user can understand clearly. So which is actually the functionality. So of course the end user always care about the functionality, and this can be achieved using the class diagrams or the sequence diagrams. Okay, the class diagrams or sequence diagrams are little low level diagrams, but they are again human readable form. They can tell you the workflow mechanism, what all the things will happen internally, and the class diagram will also tell you what kind of data are we going to capture. So that will give you a good user view. And the second one, the development view. So what development view will actually give you is what a programmer want to look at or what he need to know. Okay, so in general, to build this entire application, this can be achieved by using a package diagram. If you give a package diagram, of course, again, if you see the arrows pointing from left to right and top to bottom, although all these are pointing to the scenarios, each will be pointing to each other again. That means a developer will also, or the development view for the programmer will also make sense to have the class diagram and sequence diagram. Okay, and also this will be reflecting back to the process view also, and so on. So that's what the arrows are reflecting to. So the programmer definitely will need to know the class diagram, sequence diagrams, and the package diagram. So this is key for you guys. So as a developer, once you get into any firm, you might be handed out a bunch of documents which might have a requirements as a big text and also use case diagrams if you're lucky. As I told you, not every firm will have the use case diagrams, and class diagrams and sequence diagrams are the heart of what you are actually looking for. If for you to go and kick off developing or writing some code, you need these two, class diagrams, sequence diagrams. That will help you in writing your code. Okay, we'll see how they look like. Okay, so as a programmer, you will be also looking for the package diagram. That means how each package, what are the package, we'll see down the line. We'll see each of these diagrams in detail. Okay, and integrator view, for example, the process view will actually gives you the runtime process view. For example, how many is it a multi-threaded application or a web farm or web garden kind of application wherein how many number of processes that are running when the application is at a high peak load and so on. So this will give you a view for a performance analyst or even at the high level architects. They can actually get a view of this process, how many processes are involved in running this application. So this will give you the information such as the runtime of each and every process that's taken, concurrency, distribution, performance, scalability, and so on. These are very, very useful for the applications which are heavily user load applications like a public portals like a Facebook or a Orkut or so on. So things like that, this view becomes a very, very critical view. So, and again, not necessary that every project need to have all of these. It's optional to choose from. Okay, so that's again a key thing. And this process view can be achieved using the activity diagrams. And the last one is a physical view, which will give you the correct view for a systems engineer. Systems engineers, in general, if you look at the architectural diagram that we've shown, what are the servers involved, and as an infrastructure architect, they will know what to build, what are the boxes going to contain. And the physical view will actually give you the, once you build the software, once you build the program, so which component will sit in which server is a question. So that will be addressed by the physical view, which can be achieved using the deployment diagram. So we'll see what a deployment diagram looks like. Okay, so that's the 4 plus 1 architectural view diagram. Of course, the scenarios at the heart. Scenarios, as you see, is achieved using the use case diagrams. we did see what are the use case diagrams as part of our discussion today, right? Good. So now comes the package diagram. So as part of the package diagram, what does it look like? If you take a close look at the, so this is pretty much the layered architecture we have seen previously. So this is nothing but each of the layer that we have seen transformed into a package. A package in general, what it means to you is an assembly. So you're going to have this project as a whole with bunch of associated classes into one library, class library project. So each of these are a package with respect to .NET. Okay, and the of course the package can also be a database stored prox. Okay, so package is a very high level term. It doesn't actually limit itself to assembly. So with respect to the .NET programs is what I referred to as an assembly. And if you talk in terms of a database, if you look at the database as a whole, which contains the tables, stored prox, all other things, so as a one database, that whole database can be one package. So what it means, you have clubbed all your scripts to create a database, tables, its indexes, its user permissions, and also the, of course, the stored prox or triggers, everything bundled into one package. So that in other words, that's the database package we have here. So this also stands as one package. And data access layer, these are the classes we're going to build to do the data access with the database stored prox. At the package diagram, surprisingly, we'll list all the classes inside each assembly. In this case, UIL is the page again. So in this case, all these are actually web pages. In this case, the code that associated to the web page in the user interface, which is actually using the business workflow layer. And also business workflow layer is using data access layer. So this is the high level layer we have seen, UI, business layer, and the data access layer. Okay, so at the high level, these are three main layers. And what they do, what they dependent on, so these are use arrow. Okay, so that means they are using this. And the, all of them are actually dependent on DOM, D-O-M, which is the data, sorry, domain object model, which is your classes that reflects to your business, which is HR. HR has an employee, department, and address, and why the address is coming out, we'll see, okay? And also it has a domain-based class. So again, it has an interface called IE, business rules. We will see why we have these interfaces, why these classes, once we get into the step, into the class diagrams, okay? And for now, okay, we have a high-level view. Okay, we have three different packages available, which are sliced out, and each of them are actually dependent on the DOM. And of course, DOM is actually making use of helper. And in this diagram, it's not actually pointed on, but otherwise, all these packages are also pointed out to the helper. So that helper is again a common thing, just like a DOM, so that all these layers can make use of helper class. And of course, database package will have the USPs in this case, USP create, create new address, new department, new employee, and your data access layer is actually using the database layer directly. So that's the package diagram. And how this is useful? This package diagram will be useful when we see the deployment diagram, okay? And one key thing I want to tell you, so I actually, if you see at the bottom, most, I'm actually putting the logo of an enterprise architect. So this is one of the very good modeling tool that I have used and I'm very, very impressed with it. So that's the reason I'm actually, all these diagrams are actually built using the enterprise architect, but not Visio. So Visio, again, you can do all of these, but personally, I don't like Visio for several reasons, because of it usability wise, and also also its extendability wise, and all, it's not that intuitive. This is one of the Microsoft products really I hate a lot. There are several occasions wherein you have to use the Visio, but I really hate using Visio, because if you really have the tool available, then you can know what I'm talking about. And of course, I think it's the best time for me to show you how can you actually create them. Again, instead of walking you through this, I will show you both the examples. How can you actually create them? I did actually create all of these diagrams using a couple of them are with Visio. I'll open the Visio. So this is how the Microsoft Office Visio looks like. And of course, if with the IDE itself, you can make yourself which one looks better. So this is the Microsoft Visio. And of course, you have a couple of UI elements on the left-hand side. And if you want to create a new type of charts, you can actually have picked one of them on the left-hand side. And of course, for us, software and database, these are the set of diagrams available. And out of them, this UML modeling is what one of them. And of course, you can actually create a sitemap and whatnot. So you actually have so much a bunch of things, including COM and OLE and so on. Database modeling, you can do it here. So Visio diagrams are completely static in nature. In other words, you know, you cannot get anything out of it in general. What I'm interested in is what all I'm going to actually do here in general. I want to actually get some benefit out of it. Just for example, I can right click on this and go to properties, and it has a very good intuitive view here. So I can actually put some text here, asset number, some tracking number and serial number and so on, right? Because it's a server, so it's actually a very good intuitive one. So it takes the information, like what is the server made of, or which room it is, and building, and so on. So this has a lot of physical inventory data that's taking. But what I can do with the data is nothing. So there is no feature in Visio to actually generate a document out of this. So what all I have to do is I just have to export this as an image that we are using a save as, and then save it as an image, and then import that image into like my presentation, like the way I have done. So that's where Enterprise Architect is really jumps well ahead in the market. And if I take a look at this Enterprise, this is another VSD that I've created for this demo again. So this has the same diagrams, the high level architectural view, and also this is a layered view. Of course, I have to play around to do some coloring and other things. It takes a lot of time otherwise. And this is use case diagrams here. Of course, if you take a look at the left hand side, these are the types of UML diagrams that you can create. And after them, you have a package diagram, you have a use case view here. And all, of course, it's pretty intuitive. You can just drag and drop here and double click and say some use case, right? It is a little intuitive, of course. If at all you have to create diagrams of your own, I'm just drag and drop a user like this, and of course give a name, say whatever, super user. And super user, of course, you want to connect him to this guy. You can actually make use of this connector. You can connect, and of course, you can actually provide its cohesion and your multiplicity, wherein the association endpoints you can define. All of this you can do, but the problem is that you cannot actually render a document out of it or make use of it. In general, as a class diagram, when I build a class diagram, especially in Visual Studio, I can actually, the benefit out of it is I can write a class diagram. At the same time, I can get the code out of it, so which is beneficial, right? Which just saves my time. That's not possible in Visio. Okay, so it's enough of Visio. So we will get into the Enterprise Architect tool once we go to the place where. Okay, let me open this here, Enterprise EAP. This is the file for Enterprise Architect that I have created, and we will walk through how it looks like. Of course, if you can Google around and search for it, there is a trial version, but there is no express edition like the Visual Basic or Visual Studio. But there is a trial version which you can make use of for 30 days, and you can keep your hands wet on this. It's going to be really good. So here I can create a ton of projects. It's another way is the Enterprise Agrid is completely a project management tool. It can do a traceability starting from the requirements to the end. You can also actually integrate or do a integration with your Visual Studio also as a debugger. You can actually do a debugging inside the EA Enterprise Agrid also. You can do a version control using the Enterprise Agrid. So there's a lot of benefits out of this. So one of the cool benefit out of this is the ability to generate a code. So that's a very rich feature. It gives you, in this case, okay, let me walk through the slide and come to the point where I can show you the package diagram. So the one other thing which we already covered is a package diagram here. This is actually very intuitive. I have these packages created within which I have these classes created, and all I need to do is just drag and drop this package to create the package diagram. It is so simple. In Visio, it's not that way. It's completely a very crooked way, wherein you have to actually drag and drop a package and then hit on this and start adding elements to it, which is not a reusability way. It's going to suck like. It's going to be really time consuming and painful work in Visio. Okay, so that's the reason I really like this tool, and all these diagrams are built using the Enterprise Agrid tool. And as I showed you, this is a package diagram, which is actually the end part of it, which is showed at the high level. Usually, once you get the layered architecture view, immediately you'll see the packages. So each of the layer, okay, each of the layer we saw in the previous one. Oh yeah, this is the one. Each of the layer usually get transformed into one project as a class library or a application. So in this case, the UI layer is the one that becomes your ASP.NET web application, and the other ones like a business workflow layer will become another class library as an isolated one completely. So these are the different projects you can visualize that. And so similarly, each of those layers will transform into the package as we have seen just now. Okay, so that's package, and next comes the class diagram. So there's a lot of thought process went in creating this class diagram to fit into our project. So let's understand what does a class diagram look like, and what are the different elements associated as part of the UML. Again, what all we are seeing is completely UML, which is Unified Modeling Language. Okay, and of course these diagrams comes with the standard notations for each of the features that you're going to show actually. So things like, you know, this arrow should have a dot, this arrow should be open, and this is a diamond symbol which should be, you know, filled black. So those are all the notations that each of them have some representation to each other. So as part of the object-oriented principles, I hope most of you are familiar with, so all of those object-oriented principles, you can actually show them in the Unified Modeling Language. So what I'm actually just scratching the surface here. I'm not actually getting into too much of details, like what is a generalization, what is an association, what is, those are completely object UML language based. There are a couple of keywords that you need to actually aware of. Since our session is not a UML, I'm just giving you a glimpse of each of these diagrams so that once you get to see them, you can easily grasp them based on the information that you're getting today. Okay, so what does a class diagram look like? And as per the UML standards, how does a class look like? Okay, so this is how the class looks like. On the top head, you have the name of the class, okay? And the bottom body, it will have the list of attributes, which can be based on, since in this case, the plus symbol again indicates it's public, and of course protected, minus, or private members will have their own symbols, like minus is private, and so on. And underscore is the name that we have given as a field, and so these are the list of attributes available as part of this class. And the bottom part will have the methods and properties which are having some behavior associated to it. So even the properties, since they have the getters and setters, they look like methods, just that they have a different way of accessing them. So these are some of the methods, the concrete methods, which has a department, which is the constructor in this case, and they validate business rules. And where did we get this validate business rules is another question. So to get to the validate business rules, we have to see the top level interface. So we have a business interface created to validate the business rules. In this case, we have the this iBusiness rules is our project specific interface, which has one method called validate business rules, and all the business entities that we have must implement that business rule. So that's called, in UML terms, it's called a realization. So this dotted arrow, means that you're realizing this interface, and that's when you're implementing that interface here. Okay. And similarly, you have the composition or containment relationship is depicted as a diamond with a filled diamond. And of course, composition and association, again, both are closely related to each other. So as I said, I'm not going to get into too much details here. Just wanted to give you the glimpse of the UML diagrams. Okay. Okay. So I think it's not yet done. So generalization is one of the key thing here. Generalization is the inheritance relationship. So what we are inheriting to? So we have a base class here created called the HR domain base. So these are the two base class we have. In other words, this can be also an abstract class. Okay, so that for our whole domain object, we have something called a base class, wherein I can actually have something common to everyone. So in this case, what I have identified is the updated by or the update timestamp. So for a given employee record or an address record, I can also this updated by the username for audit trailing purpose. That information is going to be very useful to log into a database so that this particular user actually did this change at this given time. So for that is going to be common to all the entities. So that's why I just identified that as part of the domain base class. So down the line, if at all I come across some attribute that can apply to any of these, instead of me going to each and every class and applying that, I can actually straight away go and put it in my base class, so that is made available to all the domain objects in my domain object model. So there's a lot of principles involved when you design this domain object model, which are primarily your object-oriented principles, of course. In this case, we see the generalization, and we don't see a polymorphism here, but we can actually extend this model to have the polymorphism implementation as well. In this case, we are actually seeing the inheritance clearly, and also containment relationships we have here. In this case, composition, in other words, containment relationship or the composition, what it indicates is the relationship between these two objects. That's what the diagram is trying to show. In this case, the address is completely separated out of these two entities, because employee also has the same address. It has a mailing address or a permanent address. Probably this is something added up as an addition to what the original requirement was talking about. It just said address, right? When we see the original requirement, but down the line, as part of the JAD sessions, we discovered that, okay, when I say address, okay, there is something called a mailing address and also a permanent address and so on as part of the employee. So that's what detail level requirements we have at this time. And we have identified, okay, address is something very common across many entities. In this case, even department has a location, which is nothing but an address. So that's when the address is completely separated from those two entities. In other words, in the database terms, it's called as a normalization. And in our in UML terms or the object-oriented terms, it's called generalization. So we actually have this object separated from each other and then made available into the respective classes wherever it's required as a containment relationship. So what this indicates is employee has an address. Okay, so that's how the relationship looks like when you talk about the generalization. So it's a very interesting thing when you talk about a relationship between two different objects. It's an elaborative topic, but right now I just wanted to show you a couple of things which are very important. Otherwise, it's a very large topic to talk about it, and probably UML is something if you can actually discover or learn more online. Okay, and yes, so that's a part of the class diagram, and this is again continuation to that. This is another class diagram at our workflow, which is a business workflow layer. And what do we have in the business workflow layer, and what does ideally a business workflow does? So we, as part of our high-level architectural view, we have seen the layered view. We have seen the UI will talk to the business workflow components. And again, keep in mind that this is what you might come to see. So once you join a firm and someone hands you a bunch of documents, then you might have to see these kind of diagrams in general. And of course, and that's why it's very important for you to know. A class diagram is something that you might not ignore. That's the heart and soul of any program. So class diagram is something is mandatory for everyone to understand. And in this case, for business workflow, what it does is going to have a bunch of methods which will create the complete command scope for a given operation to fulfill. Okay, give an example. In an employee screen, save an employee is an action item on the screen. User will fill in all the UI fields, ID, name, age, so on, and then hit save. So what will happen when he hit save? So hit save will actually call the BWC layer immediately, passing the employee object. So what all the action items you have to fulfill in order to make sure to tell the user that save successful? Okay, so underlying what you need to do is you need to actually do some business rules validation and validate the inputs. If there are any errors, show them back. Otherwise, you talk to the business, your data access layer, and so on. So the set of action items that you need to do under every method. So business workflow components, or in this case business workflow class, I would say under business workflow layer. Okay, BWL layer, and that's when the namespace, in other words, called BWL in the layered view. Once you get into the class level, it's called as a BWC. In other words, we can call it as a business workflow class. Some have a different names. Okay, don't worry about the names. Some call it as just like a BL, business layer. Some call it as a BC, business component. Some call it as a DC, like a data container, something like that. So people will have a different names for the same thing, but ideally they all stand for same thing. Okay, so ideally you will have a UI, we'll call another layer. In our terms, we are calling it as a BWC. Someone might call something else, don't mind. So that will have actually tie up different action items into one. For example, another example will be, for example, if you want to create, in this case, an employee into a database, since we have address as a separate entity, employee as a separate entity, so you might have to have two inserts into address and one insert into employee table. Although, as of now, we haven't seen a database model. You can actually visualize the class diagrams as a database model. So that's this is, in other words, the complete picture of how the database tables look like. In this case, we can actually visualize as employee table, the address table, and department table. One-to-one mapping, you can visualize it that way. So in this case, I might, for just to save an employee here, I just have to do two inserts into employee address table and one insert into employee table. So there are three commands associated to it. So to do that, we have to have three operations, right, altogether. So that's what the workflow will decide, and workflow again decides which one should go first and which one should go next. So in our previous example, of course, first the main record is the employee, wherein you have the employee ID as a referential integrity to the address. So the first thing should go in is the employee, and then the address. So that's the law workflow you're going to define as part of each and every action item in the workflow class here. And since we are going to do pretty much a database driven application, so and we see common things in a database driven application of CRUD. So if you see, it's a common thing is create, retrieve, update, and delete. So this is again a common keyword you might come across in a real-time situation. So as a CRUD operation, simply CRUD operations, what it means is create, retrieve, update, and delete. So that's what is associated to a normally database-driven applications. So this is completely driven with the database applications. Okay, so that's what we are trying to do. So what we have here is again same. So since we will have the create, delete, retrieve, and update in all of these scenarios, so all of those operations we defined as an interface. So since because to keep our consistency in the naming, we have defined these contracts so that each of these contracts, if you take a close look, they take HR domain based class. Okay, so what this is means is HR domain based class, but in this case when I do an add new to an employee class, I actually need an employee class here, not a domain based class, right? By making your signature generic enough, so this is an advantage of having a domain base again here. So since all of these classes inherit from HR domain based class, you can actually have a signature generic enough to take HR domain based class. So that if you remember the with respect to delegates, we have the covariates and contravariants. So that principle talks about if you have the signature defined with the base class name, and you can actually create instance of that and pass in any subtype. When you create it, so you can actually, when you create an instance of a domain employee BWC and call the create new method, you can actually pass employee or address or department, because all of them are actually inherited from domain base class. Okay, so that's how this is useful. And interfaces, again, if someone asks you a good question, which is a very, very common question, so when will you use an abstract class and when will you use an interface, you can actually give them a good answer like this. So you know a very good use of an interface, whenever there is a need for you to have a same signature implemented by many other classes, you can actually make them, for consistency sake or for identity sake, you can actually make them expose as an interface. So that in another typical example here, in this case, for example, business rules, right? If these objects implement the business rules, then straight away in my BWC implementation, immaterial of what, right? Once I receive my HR domain-based class here, I know for sure that you actually have to implement this business rules. So in my workflow, first thing I will do is once I get my HR domain based class, I'm going to just invoke that method by name, validate business rules. Okay, so you have to provide the implementation for the validate business rules to make it happen. So as part of the whole workflow concern, it makes your work seriously easy. That's when your interfaces are really helpful. So that means whenever you're invoking a generic implementation, you can actually blindly call that given method. Okay, I know that you will have this method, and I can straight away make a call to it to validate your business rules. That's what in BWC you can make use of the interfaces very efficiently. And also we have the interface in BWC layer, so that in my workflow I can also call the create new directly. Whenever I do a create operation, whenever I do an update operation, I know that there is something called delete operation or update operation and so on. Okay, so yep, I think this is a typo here. I need to fix this. This is not an update employee. This is supposed to be just an update, because update employee and interface doesn't make sense, because in interface it should be a very generic keyword. It should not be associated to a specific object here. So this is wrong. Don't go with that. So I can actually fix that later, but for now let it be as an error. Okay, so this is found as part of the review. Good. Okay, yeah, so this is again the interface realization as in terms of the UML. And of course, what are we are looking at is a structural UML. Structural UMLs, we'll talk about all these diagrams which are related to the package or the class diagrams or the component diagrams. These are all become, say, structural UML. There are a bunch of other things as part of the structural UML diagrams. For example, if I go and create a new diagram here, here I can see what all the structural diagrams, say like a package, class, object, composite structure, so on. So and some of them we have, see, in our session we're going to see the package, we already saw one. A class diagram we have seen just now, and deployment diagram which is coming next. And behavioral diagram, we have the use case diagram, we already saw one, and activity diagram we're going to see soon, and sequence diagram we're going to see, and the rest all we're not going to see. Again, rest all are not going to be again that often used, so that's why you don't really have to worry about it. Okay, so yeah, coming to the class diagram, in this case, right, let me come to my class diagram. Where am I? DOM. So this is my class diagram, and this is what the relationship I'm talking about. And what is the benefit in Enterprise Architect, right? So once I have this model created, what I can do is simply go and create a code out of it. So I'm not actually wasting time in actually drawing these pictures here. That's the advantage in Enterprise Architect. So I can actually play around with these diagrams. This is going to be completely useful for me to write a code as well as to write a document. It really generates a very good document, which is very useful. You can just have to copy and paste it into your detailed design documents, which you need to produce as at the end of the design phase. It contains the images as well as the text that you want to put in. In this case, if I go here and put some constraints like details and constraints here and put some text, all that can be all the notes at the field level notes I can add up here. All that information I can actually extract out directly. In this case, right, another thing we, for example, it's pretty intuitive again. You just have to double click on that. And in this case, this is just a attribute. If you want to add a new one, I can say just new. Since it's going to be a private field, that's why I'm going to put an underscore in front of it. That's just my naming convention, otherwise it's not needed. And put some text, and it's a type. You can put in the scope, you can pick whatever it is. Since it identifies that we are going to play with C#, that's why. And of course the language, we need to set the language. Okay, I'm just going to go back to class level, sorry. You need to pick the language that you want to do. So this language here, it can take ActionScript, C++, Delphi, Java, so any language that you want to choose. And you need to, by default, it somehow it's picking Java, so I have to change it manually to C#. And that's when it identifies your respective methods, types, and other things, stereotypes, and other things, to whatever it is. And of course, my internal memories, internal ones I don't want to keep public, so I can keep them private. And then create a new one, save. Okay, so now once I have this private one, so this has a locked one, I'm going to, oh sorry, where is the new? Did I create here? Looks like I just changed this one. Okay, I will make it public again. I want to create a new one and say underscore new and make it private. And see, the property box checkbox is disabled by default. So once you, if you want to create a property, first you need to actually create a local variable of private access modifier and then save, and then select this one and then make this as a property. Then it will ask you to create property. And now in this case, the property name, you want to change it to new, and you want to have a get scope as a public, definitely one public, and a read and write, of course read and write, and then say okay. So what it does is it's going to create a local identifier as well as, in this case, since I made this local identifier as a private, the diagram is actually showing as a minus, right? For plus indicates it's public. So that's how we can actually build this entire model and visualize what are the base class items available and what are the derived items available, and you can actually code, in other words, visually. And once it is done, once you finalize this, you can actually go to the this way, either this way, or you can actually pick the whole package. So in this case, I will pick only one of the class here, let's say employee, and right click and say generate code, and it already have a fixed path here. I'll just copy that path. This is, I believe it's taking the root path where, okay, so I already have some of the files generated. I'm going to delete them. And then hit generate. So in other words, you can actually generate for a whole project in a single click. You don't have to actually generate one by one. So actually, since a lot of my private variables, I defined them as a public, that's why it actually written this code out as a public. And of course, it has the constructor. What it will have is the skeleton of each and everything with the properties. It got getters and setters, so it's the way you want to do. So you don't have to really write all of these code. Probably you might have to fix a couple of things like these errors. So it's failing because it didn't generate the whole project and it doesn't have the respective interface available as part of this code. That's why this is failing. So otherwise, you can see the value out of the diagram. So once you do the design in the modeling tool, you can get two things out. One, the document that you can submit as is as part of your deliverable, and also the source code which can be used for the next development cycle, which is the development. So once you get the source code built out, all you need to do is just start writing code in the respective blocks. You don't have to write the properties, methods, the signature and all that thing. And of course, once you do this, you can also reverse engineer that that piece by doing synchronizing model with code. You can do this and you'll get the model reflected back into your diagram. So it's two-way, it's a duplex. In other words, it's two-way communication between the model versus the code. Okay, so that's very, very, very useful, definitely. Okay, so that's the features in Enterprise Architect tool. But Visio, if you're getting to Visio, then none of that is available. And next one is the data access layer. The data access layer also comes with the same thing. And since we identified that there is a defect with my model with respect to my BWL, let me take this opportunity to fix it. So how do I do that? I will have to select this update, yep, and double click. Either I can change it here, but I would prefer, I can just, let me change it here. Just an update, nothing else. Okay, good. So it just updated it, and but this one did not reflect the change, right? So in this case, what I can do is I can actually delete this, and let me drag and drop and see, and paste as a link. Yeah, but still, it did not go away. So what I can do the best is, I can actually just copy my name to just to create a new brand new one. Okay, delete it completely from my model. Okay, completely delete it, and create a new class with the same name, employee, apply, okay, and if you see the arrow here, all I need to do is drag and drop, and you see a lot of options here. So these are called composition, aggregation, association, realization. In this case, since it is interface, I'm actually realizing. So these are the typical keywords that you need to know as part of the UML. Those are all completely UML terms. And once I do realization, it actually listing all the methods that I have to inherit and implement. So I can actually choose some of them, but ideally for interface, we have to actually select all. There's no other option, right? Okay, then say okay. So that's all you need to take. And you have all the brand new employee VWC. How easy it is? It's pretty easy for me to do this way. Instead of writing the same methods every place, and you know, even in normally in the code wise, if you have to change it one place, of course, you just have to correct the respective places. That's what we're going to do. And department VWC. So it's nice to have some errors in the model so that I can also demonstrate how to fix them. So in this case, again, department VWC is gone. And I'm just creating another class here. I'll say department VWC and say apply, okay, and drag and drop, say realization, select all, okay. So that's my class is ready. So it's that fast. And once I do that, I just, you know, as I said, we can actually generate a code out of it and also document out of it. That's cool. Okay, we'll also see if you try to create a document out of it. A documentation, yeah, rich text format, switch the generator, okay. Pick all these options and then output to ctemp, say some name, test.rtf, okay, it's fine, and template name. I can actually save this settings as a template here, that's what it meant to say, and instructions, this is a test document something. And I can also pick something here, create a new document on all. Yep, yeah, I can now just create a glossary task issues. Let me pick everything. So document all elements, yeah, and document packages, yes, and script root package, yeah, whatever, no. Hide noteless, no. Embed the diagram in the document. This is important, yes. So and also don't exclude anything. Okay, now create has been created, good. And let me go back and see to my text dot, there is some 67 KB. I hope there is something out of this. And FYI, actually I didn't put any field level description, so that's why I don't expect detailed notes here, but otherwise it actually extracted everything, like from where, dependencies, sources, BWC, UI, so a lot of information it actually extracted out, and all this I can actually customize, and of course the beautiful diagram also is available as part of the document, and this is a glossary that I put at the top. So this is a pretty useful document that you can present directly as your deliverable detailed design document. And it's pretty much, if you really have to write all this by yourself, it's going to take a ton of time, right? So I'm able to demonstrate the code generation as well as the document generation. So let's finish our presentation. This is the detailed design phase. We are with the data access layer implementation again. So data access layer is similar to my BWC interface. I have the IHR data access layer. wherein I have these standard interfaces for CRUD operations and respective data access layers. What these data access layer components are going to do is whenever there's a create new, delete, update for the respective employee. So this is an employee specific DAC, and this is an address specific DAC, and this is a department specific DAC. Imagine employee table, employee business object. We'll talk to the employee DAC so that it will have the respective stored proc mapping to the create new method, and then it's going to create the parameters, database parameters from the data elements that we have from the employee object. So employee object has the respective data, and once you have the BWC, like create new, pass the employee object here. The BWC will actually call the data access component using the create new, passing the data access your employee object. So in this implementation wise, what you're going to do is you're going to create the database parameters and the stored proc name that you already have written in the database side as part of the DB package, and invoke the stored proc using your edo.end. That's it. So it's going to be straightforward, right? So whenever you want to create a new employee, all you need to do is you create the instead of employee DAC and pass employee data and just create new. That's it. So all this, whatever I just said, okay, so we can actually see that in one glimpse, and that diagram is called a sequence diagram, which is coming next to this activity diagram. So now we'll see an activity diagram. So activity diagrams pretty much looks like this. It has a starting state, an ending state, and also this is called the black circle is called a start initial state, where your program actually starts from here. So in this case, this is actually showing a demonstration how to save a data successfully into a system. So what you're going to do is enter data in the UI. So you're going to enter the data, and this is again activity diagram is similar to the data flow diagrams. If you know what is the data flow diagrams, then you will know what is an activity diagram. So only difference is that activity diagrams are UML standards, whereas the data flow diagrams are not. So that means the shapes and a couple of shapes and symbols or terminologies are a little different in the UML diagrams. Okay, so in this case, this is called initial state, and then this whole rectangle rounded one is called the activity. The whole thing is an activities, and the last one is the final state. The diamond is a decision, so that's called a decision point. Okay, so what we're trying to do here is this is a self-explanatory. So as a programmer or the developer, you might see an activity diagram to really write your code. So what is happening here is that take an entry, as if you visualize an entry screen and enter data there, and what immediately going to happen is validate the data. Of course, once you hit the save button, you want to validate the data. And of course, the validation of the data will have a decision out. It could be a fail or pass. If your validation is failed, then what will happen is show the errors on the screen and go back to your initial state, wherein you will be in the enter state only. So user will have to fix the errors again and then again submit it, and again do the validation again and then come back to your decision block. And then if it is passed, then what you're going to do is save to the database. And save to the database operation will save the data into the data store, which is a database. So this action item is a data store. This is a state. And finally, you receive and data saved successfully state. So that's how an activity diagram will detail you how the operation should go on. So this is one of the simplest example. This will be very complex if it is a very complex logic that you have to write to. So usually this can be provided by your business analyst, what are their internal logics, or your team lead. They normally prepare these kind of structured diagrams so that for the programmer to go and write the program to fit this activity. Okay, and next comes to the sequence diagram. So this is one of the most useful diagram for you. So as I mentioned verbally, that you have a BWC layer, you will call this method passing this, and then that will BWC implementation will actually call this. So it's a lot of information in air, right? So that information I can put it in a document, in a diagram called a sequence diagram. So this diagram will tell you, since I have all these individual components built, how these components interact with each other is what we're going to show in a diagram. And in this case, user, of course, you and me, will go and hit the employee UI page. And on the page, you have a click event. Of course, you have a button and the user click the click button. And the click event, what it has is you're going to create instance of the employee. It's going to immediately call the DOM, which is your assembly, and the employee class. So it's going to call the constructor. If you see employee with open brackets, default constructor is what we're calling. And that means you're creating instance of this employee object. And in return, what you get is an instance of employee, right? So this is called the lifeline. So this call lifeline ends here. So it called the create instance and it got the instance back. But if you see the lifespan of the click, it started here and it actually ended here. So that's the lifespan of the click. So this diagram shows you the calls and their lifespan throughout the program. Okay, so once you get the instance, the first step is what? You're going to create instance of a class, and you know how to create an instance of a class by looking at the diagram, right? And next thing is, of course, you go to call the create new method of the employee class. So you're going to say employee.createNew and pass the employee object that you have written. Of course, in between, you have to populate the employee with the UI input fields. I did not put that step here to keep it simple. Otherwise, I had to actually show employee.id is equal to textbox.id, whatever UI elements and so on. I don't want to put so lengthy sequence diagram, which will be very clumsy and not readable. To keep it simple, I just added a straightaway step to create new. Of course, consider that you have populated this employee instance with the data fed by the user in the UI. Okay, good. And then create new, what it is calling immediately in the BWC layer. So create new of what? Create new of BWC. So we created an instance of BWC and then call the create new. Again, that step I didn't put here for the sake of simplicity. And then call the create new of BWC instance passing employee. Now, next step. What will BWC will do? So BWC immediately is going to actually call the validate business rules of the employee class, right? So employee it gets and simply calls validate business rules. So implementation is actually part of the employee, which BWC is completely not aware of. Okay, so this is again part of the separation of concern. So who is responsible to provide the implementation to validate the data? Employee class. Okay, and it does the validation where checking for all the required fields and all the expressions for email ID and of course date of birth validation and so on. It does all the validation and finally it returns an array of strings back. Okay, this call will return an array of string. That means what the next immediate conditional thing is. Okay, we're going to see if this string.count, if the string.count is zero, that means create new of the BWC layer. So you're going to call the DAC, data access class, create new only when this condition is satisfied. Okay, that means there are no business validation errors. Okay, if there are any business validation errors, then definitely you're going to return immediately from here. Okay, in this case, it's not that elaborate. So again, just have to use your visualization. We're trying to show that if there are no business rules errors, then you're going to go forward. Otherwise, you're going to go back from here itself. In this case, we consider that this is equal to zero. That means there are no business rules validation. And then we're going to immediately call the data access. Of course, DAC will actually make call the database directly, the stored proc. Okay, it's going to call the stored proc by building the database parameters and the USP. So you know which USP you want to call and what are the parameters going to take, and you're going to do that implementation between this and then call invoke the database and then come back with the database errors if any. Otherwise, of course, there are no errors. So if there are any database errors at this point, that will be captured by the DAC and added to the errors list string. Okay, so at the end when I call the create new, if this the return has some count of strings, that means some error happened. It could be either business rules error or it could be database error. Okay, in either case I'll have the error as part of the string array as a return type. Good. So for that return type, return is actually passed all the way to the screen. Okay, so what did click did? It actually called the create new of the employee and then called the BWC and then called the DAC, data access layer component, and then the database root proc. And finally we got the return out to the user saying, in this case here you're going to write a logic saying, okay, if the strings.count is equal to 0, then show message saying saved successfully. Otherwise, show all the errors that you have in this string. Then user will see the errors in the screen. So that's the detail level. So as a developer, if you look at this sequence diagram, then you can know what you need to write, right? So immediately you can figure out, okay, on the click of the button, what I have to do, I have to do this. That's it, you're done. So this is one of the very useful diagram that a developer can get. If you ask a simple question, if you're trying for a position of a team lead, and someone asks you, so what are the key documents that you will deliver to your developers for them to start coding from day one? So if someone has joined your team, day one, he is a C# guy. We hired him for C#, so what are the documents you think you can deliver him? Definitely, no one can sit and explain you the whole project. Never happens, right? Don't ever expect your team leads or project managers sit with you hours together and explain you the whole project and all these things. What they will do in return is, as part of their analysis, they will build these documents and these diagrams, and they will just hand over those set of diagrams to you. And what you need to do is, you need to just walk through the diagrams and understand what you need to do it. And if at all you have some questions, you're always free to ask questions. There's no problem. But don't expect someone to sit with you and explain you what you have to do. So if it is a completely process-driven firm, they might give you all these documents, definitely. And it's not mandatory for every project to do this. For most of the projects, if they are not process-oriented firms, they might not do any of these documentations. So, of course, there is always advantages with having a process-oriented firms and also disadvantages. The disadvantage of having a process-oriented, heavy process like these, building so many diagrams, documents, and other things, is that, you know, things will go slow. And of course, if anything we want to change, you have to change the diagram, document, and everything. So it's going to be a more laborious job than less coding, but it's going to be more useful down the line. So down the line, at the end of the project cycle, you have the set of good documentation. Whoever gets into your project, it's very easy. No one have to sit with them and explain what it's doing. All is explained in a document. Okay, so that's advantages of the documentation. So again, so why I took you this painful route of showing so many diagrams and explain you each of them. So UML is, although it's not our topic, I did because this is what you might see once you get into a project, and which is what you are actually looking for. And the last one, is a deployment diagram wherein, as I mentioned, so this is pretty much the engineering perspective view, wherein this diagram will tell the hardware engineer to deploy. Once you finish your product, once you compile it as a release candidate and you're given the release candidate to a engineer who is going to do the deployment, he need to know which one goes where. As we see that we, as part of infrastructure diagram, we have two things, right? We have a database server, we have an application server, and so on. So in this case, this diagram will actually tell you what to do what. Okay, so in this case, we have these artifacts, these are called an artifacts. In this case, all my HR database scripts are an artifacts. This will have the whole bunch of scripts as one bundle. It could be simple as a zip file. You have a bunch of SQL scripts as a zip file, and all the SQL scripts were related to creating a database, creating the indexes, creating some day zero data, or creating the your database store procs, whatnot, or triggers, and all that things what your application need to run. Okay, so this is a final database script. And what the engineer need to do is he just need to actually deploy them. He will deploy to a HR database. It's a server. Again, this is an instance of a database called HRDB on a database server. Okay, and this database server has a configuration, has a hardware configuration, which is a number of cores. It's a quad core processor, and the database is SQL Server 2008, and it has some kind of HDD number of hard disks. We have four random RAID disks of 100 GB each. That's what it means. And operating system is Windows Server 2008 R2, and processors, we have, again, four, as I said, it's a quad core. We have four processors, each of which has a 2.28 gigahertz, and RAM is 8 GB. So that's what it talks about, which is, again, part of the infrastructure diagram at the high level. So at the end, this is a diagram which is going to be useful for the deployment cycle. So you build it, you zip it up and send it to a deployment team. So deploy team will look into this and will deploy the respective artifacts to the respective servers as per the instructions. And similarly, we have the other artifacts here. One is the HR web service, another one is the HR web application. Since we know that we have a three-tier architectural model, so that's when we have these three different artifacts. One is a web service, which will host on the IIS server again, 7.5, and again, your web application is also hosted on the same IIS server. And of course, this is a web server, which is a separate box, and this is a database server, which is a separate box. And that's what a deployment diagram looks like. And that's all the end of the session for now. We have started the HR project in this session, and we did walk through the functional requirements that we're trying to address in this project. We have all the UI requirements, report requirements, the data requirements, and the non-functional requirements such as the security, diagnostic log and everything, and we did see all the development tools that we decided to go and develop this application. We did see the use case diagrams on overview as part of the design phase, and also we did see the system design, like a high level solution architecture diagram, and we did walk through the infrastructure architecture diagram, and also the an overview about the JAD session, which is joint application design, and the detailed design phase. We did see a 4+1 architectural view model, which covers a lot of insights, one of the best adopted model to cover all the aspects of a given project to addressing various different audiences within the project. And also we did see the package diagram and the UML diagrams, and we did walk through the Enterprise Architect tool, and I did show you the difference between an Enterprise Architect and as well as the Microsoft Visio, and most of these diagrams were built in using the Enterprise Architect tool, and we did also see the class diagrams and what are the different components you will ideally look in the class diagrams, all the inheritance, implementation, realization, and all that stuff. And we also see the detailed design for the business workflow layer and the DOM, and also the data access layer class diagram. And we did see the activity diagram, how it looks like. It's purely UML diagrams generated out of Enterprise Architect tool. And we did see the most useful sequence diagram. And we did walk through all the different aspects of a sequence diagram, such as the message exchange and the lifeline and so on. And with this, we completed the design phase in this session. We'll continue with the development cycle in the next session.